Good morning, welcome to church, and happy Easter. My name is Todd Funk, and I'm a friend of Eastgate and Pastor Allen. I've spoken at the church many times. Maybe you recognize me. Obviously, we're not able to do this live today. We'll do it podcast. And today, I'm going to talk about the foundations of your Christian faith, which is really important because some people's faith is being tested and even shaken right now. Let me begin by prayer. Father, I do pray that this message would bless and encourage, God, instill confidence and build a great foundation into those that are believers, those that are struggling in their faith, God. I pray that you would be exalted and blessed and extolled in Jesus' name. Amen. So, just like any structure, in order to build a structure, you need a good and large foundation. For instance, I built a Jenga tower over here. You can't see this. But it's got a nice firm foundation. If I compare this to the Christian life, if you have a good foundation on the tower in your Christian life, you can build it as tall as you like. The height would represent the number of years you've been a Christian. The height would also represent the number of trials and tribulations you've gone through, the shakings of life. Because I've got a good foundation, I could even shake the table a little bit. Now, let me compare that to building on a different foundation over at the sandbox that I built my granddaughter. So as you can see, I've started to build a Jenga tower, but on the sand of my granddaughter's sandbox. And this might represent your Christian life. When you're young, even if you don't have a great foundation, you can go to youth group, be all happy and stuff. But as you get older and the trials of life come and the disappointments of life come, you can see the Jenga tower starting to lean because of its lack of good foundation. And if we're not careful, that tower can lean to the point where people will actually, get so frustrated that they give up on their faith, that their tower actually falls over. I think we're going there now. And great is the fall of that tower. So, what are the things that people build their lives on, their Christian lives on, that are a poor foundation? Well, let's ask the question, what is the foundation of your Christian life? Or put a different way, if someone were to ask you, why are you a Christian, what answer would you give them? Let's go back to the table. So to the question, why are you a Christian? Why am I a Christian? I've heard several answers. For instance, some would say, I was born into a Christian household and have never known any different. Others would say, Jesus changed my life. I stopped using drugs, or I'm no longer depressed, or he gave me purpose. Some would say, I feel his presence. I just know he's there, especially when I sing. I just know on the inside, or he makes me at peace. He gives me peace like nothing and no one else. Or I've seen miracles that I can't deny. And so, are these real reasons? Yes. Are they valid reasons? Yes. These reasons will be enough to last some people their entire Christian life and their tower is never in jeopardy. But are they objective or subjective? In other words, something that's subjective is subject to your own opinion. A personal perspective influenced by individual bias or based on personal opinions, feelings, emotions, or points of view. In other words, to say, I like math better than I like history, that's subjective. Or I like chocolate chip ice cream better than I like Tutti Frutti or vanilla, that's subjective. But what about objective answers? What's something objective? Well, objective is based on facts which can be verified rather than feelings or opinions, not influenced by feelings. For instance, that 2 + 2 = 4 is certainly objective. Can't argue with that. We could talk about the height of the building or the length of this table. We could verify those. So, like, what about cereal, your choice of cereal? Would that choice be objective or subjective? Well, they could be both. Subjective would be, I like this one best. It tastes the best. Or this box is designed the best. Or these make me feel most energetic. You could also choose your cereal objectively, saying which has got the most calories or which has got the most dietary fiber or on and on. You could look at the ingredients on the side. And what about Christianity, though? Is Christianity based purely on subjective? Some would argue that people's faith is just a matter of preference, like a choice in cereal taste or ice cream taste. But others could say it's a little bit more objective. So going back to the six reasons I gave before, well, look at how subjective they can appear. In other words, that you were born into a Christian household, well, some people weren't. That Jesus changed your life. Well, a lot of things can change people's lives. Going to Alcoholics Anonymous or having a great teacher or father figure. You feel his presence. Well, some people don't feel any presence at all. Some people feel a presence at a Bono, at a U2 concert. Or you just know on the inside. Well, that's pretty subjective, isn't it? He makes me at peace. Some people drink alcohol or do other things that they feel at peace about or meditate. Or I've seen miracles and people would say, well, yes, David Copperfield, David Blaine, these guys can do miracles or fake miracles. You're just easily persuaded. And so the answers are a bit subjective. And speaking real honestly, if my Christian life were based solely on those premises that I just shared, I can tell you that my tower would have fallen. We came here in 2004 to do ministry work. We worked with an evangelistic ministry, and everything was going good until 2008, and everything seemed to fall apart. For instance, in 2008, we had an investment down in Wanaka, and of course, 2008 was a global financial crisis, and the person we invested with wasn't very honest, and that all fell apart. We lost our life savings. In 2008, things went very sideways with our 17-year-old daughter. As you know, some teenagers, they go off the rails a bit. And then lastly, to probably make it the most painful, the ministry we were with, well, things went sideways with that as well. And we ended up leaving out of there and very hurt and very wounded. And I can tell you, if that was the basis of my faith, I would have been really questioning God and questioning Christ and his goodness and all those things. And so you might say, well, then what is the non-subjective? What is the objective foundation of Christian life? Well, it's the sole premise, the foundational truth on which Christianity is based, the keystone. And that is the historical fact of Jesus' life, his death, and specifically his resurrection. Let's look and see what the scripture says about that. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 17 through 18. It says, unless Christ has been raised to life, your faith is useless, and you are still living in your sins. And those people who have died after putting their faith in him are completely lost. So what the verse is basically saying is, if Christ didn't really raise from the dead, then our Christianity is useless and worthless. We might as well be going golfing on a Sunday morning. I'm going to give four key facts that give very strong evidence and are best explained by the resurrection. And I want to approach this like a detective, like Sherlock Holmes, who doesn't miss a thing when he's investigating things. Every little cigarette butt, every little plant or pot out of place, every little window that's open means something to him, and he often solves a case by that. And if we approach some of the events surrounding the death and resurrection of Christ, then we can use the Sherlock approach and see what facts point towards a resurrection. For the sake of making an argument and making a case, we won't treat the New Testament like the sacred, divine, God-inspired book that it is. We'll treat it like any other first century historical document. You might be surprising to learn that the four facts I'm going to share with you are agreed upon by secular historians, not Christian historians, secular historians. But when you take a big magnifying glass to it, like Sherlock Holmes, you find a lot of evidence there that strongly support a resurrection. So the first fact, I'll ask a question. It's this. What happened to Jesus' body after the crucifixion? Well, we look at the scripture. It says Jesus was buried in a tomb by Joseph of Arimathea. And you might say, well, so what? Well, the fact is really significant because it means that the location, the burial site, was known. Now, have you ever seen this guy? You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. You ain't nothing but a hound dog, crying all the time. Well, you ain't never come around and you ain't no friend of mine. You ain't nothing but a hound dog. The king of rock and roll. He died in 1977, and of course, after his death, many people claimed that he was still alive. Elvis sightings were popular. How would you prove otherwise if you absolutely had to prove that no, he's not alive, he's dead? Well, I would submit to you this. Over 750,000 people go and visit his gravesite at Graceland, his mansion, every year. And if you really, really wanted to prove that he was still, that he really was dead, all you'd have to do was dig it up, exhume the body, show the bones, match the DNA. Now, the disciples could never have proclaimed that Jesus rose from the dead in Jerusalem if he hadn't done so. Why? Well, because we know where the empty tomb was, right? If Jesus stayed dead, all you'd have to go and visit was tombs such as these, like Buddha, Muhammad, Joseph Smith, or Elvis Presley. But the only thing there is to visit, even 2,000 years later, is an empty tomb. That's a heritage that he left us, an empty tomb. Now, some people claim, like the Muslims, that he wasn't really dead. He just kind of swooned on the cross. He was fainted on the cross or whatever. But that doesn't make sense for two reasons. One, the Romans were great. They had perfected the art of execution and crucifixion. They would have lost their lives if they would have botched the job and left somebody alive. And secondly, Jesus was wrapped in 50 kilograms, give or take, of linen wrappings. And so let me ask you two questions. Number one, how long would you survive in something like this? And secondly, with lack of oxygen, secondly, if you did wake up being wrapped up, as the Bible says, how on earth would you unwrap yourself? So that doesn't hold weight. I mean, would a barely alive Jesus, a swooned Jesus, inspire worship, inspire the growth of a New Testament church? I don't think so. So let's take our magnifying glass like Sherlock Holmes and look at another point in this section here. He was buried in a tomb by Joseph of Arimathea. Now, if you look and do a little bit of research, Joseph of Arimathea was a member of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was the Jewish council that were responsible for putting Jesus to death in the first place. If it weren't for Joseph putting him in a nice tomb, Jesus would have been thrown in a mass grave, a very inglorious death, and not even a burial. But Joseph is the hero of the story. If the disciples were making this up, why on earth would they have somebody from the Sanhedrin being the hero of the story in giving Jesus a proper burial, a dignified burial? If they were making it up, Peter or somebody else would have been the one to do such a noble thing. Now, it's significant to note that no other competing stories exist from the first century, no myths or legends or any other history out there, anything other than Jesus was buried in a tomb by Joseph of Arimathea. Nothing else competes with that. Now, our second fact for examination, well, I'll ask another question. Who was it that found the empty tomb on the third day? If you'll recall, it was the women. On the Sunday following his death, Jesus' tomb was found empty by a group of his women followers. And you might ask, well, so what? Couple things about the so what. We'll take the magnifying glass in. The first thing is that the story is very simple. It's not embellished like legends and myths do. It's not like the fisherman's tale. Alan's a fisherman, and he might know people that the first time they tell a fish and say it was this big, and the longer the story goes, the more it gets told. As time goes on, the fish eventually ends up being larger and larger and as large as the boat. Well, this doesn't display any of the tales and signs of legends and myth. It was very, very simple. That he was buried by Joseph of Arimathea, that the body was discovered by a group of women followers. That women discovered the empty tomb is quite significant. Now, we would miss that in this day and age and centuries later, because women are just as equally good to testify in courts and tell what they saw as men. In the first century, however, women had a very different status. Women were like property. They were deemed as cattle or children or furnishings. And they certainly didn't, their evidence was not allowed in courts of law. They couldn't testify. They were too emotional and prone to sensationalism. And so to have women to be the first of eyewitness testimonies displays the fact that they weren't trying to make anything up. If you were making this up or making up legends or trying to make people believe something was false, and it wasn't true anyway, you would have a man, maybe Peter or Paul or somebody significant, discovering the empty tomb. Now, the Jewish made the allegation that they didn't deny that there was an empty tomb. What they did is they made up a story that actually the body was stolen, and that accounts for it. And some people have said, well, that makes more sense, doesn't it, that somebody stole the body rather than Jesus rose from the dead. But nobody had any motive to. For instance, grave robbers. Why would they even go near it? Jesus had nothing of value that was there. It wasn't like he was King Tut and adorned in gold and jewelry and diamonds and whatnot. The only thing of value was his seamless robe, and that had already been gambled away at the foot of the cross, as you recall. The only thing left in there were the linen wrappings. What about the Romans? Would they have stolen it? Well, no. Jesus was a thorn in their side. He was a troublemaker. They were set there in Galilee in the area to keep the peace, keep you know, from a revolt or an insurrection from happening, and they would be the last ones to want to take that out of there. What about the Jewish people? Well, the Jews thought he was a heretic. The Jews were the very ones responsible for him being crucified in the first place as a heretic of God. Well, what about the disciples stealing the body? Prime suspects. We'll get back to them a little bit later on. So, reviewing the facts, the fact that the location of the tomb was known lets you know that anybody that would have doubted it could have taken you there and said, look, here's the body, here it lies. This is a fabrication, it's a myth. Jesus didn't rise from the dead. The second is the simple story about Easter Sunday and the tomb being empty by women. Thirdly, were there any eyewitnesses to the event? Well, we look back to the scripture in 1 Corinthians 15:3-7. It says, Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said he would. He was buried. He was raised from the dead in the third day, just as scripture said he would be. He appeared to Peter. Then he appeared to 12. So what? Well, he didn't just appear to an individual, but he appeared to groups. It says in verse 6, after that, he appeared to more than 5,000 believers at the same time. Most of them are still living, but some have died. So our third key fact in investigating this and trying to find the most reasonable explanation to it is that Jesus appeared to many people after his death. He appeared to different people in different locations under different circumstances. He didn't just appear to believers, to his followers. He appeared to the Jews. He appeared to unbelievers. He even appeared to hostile witnesses. Now, the accounts of that have multiple attestations, in other words, multiple independent eyewitnesses, are always the strongest and hold up the best in the court of law. If you were trying to prove anything and you had a dozen or two dozen eyewitnesses, the more eyewitnesses you had, the stronger your case would be. The witnesses of his resurrection were in Jerusalem at the right time. The witnesses were in the right time, in the right place. It wasn't like the witnesses lived someplace else a century later. They were right then and right there. In Luke chapter 1, verses 1-3, many people, this testifies that the disciple didn't make it up, that no other accounts were circulated at the time. Many people have attempted to write about the things that have taken place among us. Reports of these things were handed down to us. There were people who saw these things for themselves from the beginning and then passed on the word. He continues, I myself carefully looked into everything from the beginning, so it seemed good to me to write down an orderly report of exactly what happened. I am doing this for you, most excellent Theophilus. Does that sound like the writings of someone who was making up mythology, fiction, fairy tales? Or somebody who's trying to record accurate history? Again, taking the magnifying glass to the text a little closer, it says, Most Excellent Theophilus. We don't know exactly who this guy is, but it's a title of somebody who is a dignitary. Would I write something to a ruler, a mayor, a prime minister, if it were fictitious, if it weren't true? Luke said he carefully researched everything to present it to this dignitary. If he was found out to be lying, if he was found out to be making things up, he might have found himself in prison, or even worse, found himself dead. And so Paul and Luke, they appeal to eyewitnesses, lots of eyewitnesses. And there's no other accounts from first century that contradict this, that say that he was making these up, or there are people that were in the audience that said, no, we didn't know these things. I mean, just less than 50 days after the resurrection event, Peter gets up and appeals to them. You yourselves are witnesses. You see that in Acts chapter 2, in Acts chapter 3, in Acts chapter 5. You were witnesses. You saw these things. Even in Acts chapter 26, Paul appeals to Festus. Excellent Festus, again, a dignitary. He says, these things weren't done in a corner. You were aware of these things that happened. And so there were no contrary evidence, no contrary to reports of the enemies of Christianity, the Jews or the Romans. No one refuted the eyewitness sightings. The fourth fact that needs to be explained, and I think is best explained by the resurrection, are the disciples. It says in 1 Corinthians 15:8, then he appeared to all the disciples. Now, what about the disciples? There's five observations about them. First of all, their leader was dead. They had no, the Jews, including his disciples, had no expectation of some resurrecting, crucified and resurrected Messiah. Their idea for centuries of a Messiah would be someone who would come in on a horse, a conquering king, a military general who would throw off the yoke of the Romans, reestablish the throne of David, and be their military hero. Not some anonymous person who was, you know, crucified on a cross. In Deuteronomy it says, cursed is everyone who dies on a tree. And so they had no expectation of a resurrection, and yet they all believed in a resurrected Christ. I mean, without a resurrection, the best they could do would be like the Muslims do, and they have a shrine for Muhammad where his body lies. Now, despite all this, the original disciples did believe in the resurrection of Christ. Secondly, regarding the disciples, was their transformation. They went from being fearful, even cowardly, to being bold and courageous. I mean, recall Peter, the night before the trial and the crucifixion, he denied even knowing Jesus, swearing that he didn't know him three times. And yet we see that same Peter on Pentecost in front of the temple with 3,000 people plus declaring that they crucified the Savior and God rose him from the dead. We see Peter and John who were imprisoned by the Sanhedrin. These were the very same people that were responsible for crucifying Jesus. They were imprisoned by the Sanhedrin in the book of Acts and told not to preach in that name anymore. What did they do? Did they cow down in fear, afraid for their own lives? No. They said, you decide whether it's better to obey God or whether to obey men. And they went out and preached Jesus just as hard as they had before. What best explains this? This boldness that they didn't have before. Well, I would submit to you that Jesus, they had heard him say while he was alive, that he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even though he dies, yet shall he live. And he made good on it when he rose from the dead. And at that point it was, oh death, where is your sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? In other words, if they threatened to beat them or take their lives, they would be like, so, and is that all you got? There's a better life, a resurrection life, and Jesus has proved that to us. The third thing about the disciples is regarding the Apostle Paul, his conversion. Now, the Apostle Paul, he was Saul before he was Paul. When he was Saul, he was very opposed to this new religion, this Christian religion. He thought they were heretics. He thought they were blasphemers. He was a persecutor of the church. He was right there when they stoned Stephen to death, the first Christian martyr there. But history records, the New Testament records, the radical transformation of Saul into the great Apostle Paul, who ends up writing two-thirds of the New Testament. What would account for that? I mean, you can compare Paul to a radical Islamic terrorist. Look at Osama bin Laden and Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the leaders of the Taliban and ISIS, respectively. Now, obviously, bin Laden's dead now. But they were both religious extremists, as was the Apostle Paul. Neither one of them are at all concerned with putting people to death and killing Christians. Neither was the Apostle Paul. He was there when they stoned Stephen to death. He was on his way to Damascus to either imprison or kill the prisoners that were there. They both thought, these guys think that they're doing Allah, God, a favor by killing the infidels, the heretics, as was the Apostle Paul. So we see a lot of parallels there. What would convert either of these two guys to Christianity? I think it would take more than seeing a miracle, perhaps a small miracle, or feeling peace or anything like that. For the Apostle Paul, we see in the scripture, last of all, he appeared also to me. We see James, the half-brother of Jesus. Now, the Bible says that neither James nor any of his brothers were believing in Jesus while he was preaching, while he was walking around doing his itinerant miracle ministry and miracles. But James was considered to become an apostle of the church in Jerusalem after the crucifixion. What would cause that? What would cause his brother from not even believing in him and none of his brothers to becoming, well, James becoming an apostle of the church. And history reports that all of his half-brothers, Jesus' half-brothers, became believers in him. What would it take to convince you that your brother or sister were the living God? I think a resurrection would do the trick. Paul's words, then he appeared to James specifically. That fills in the missing piece of the puzzle. The fifth thing about the disciples were all of them spent their lives testifying about the resurrection. Several were even martyred for their death. For instance, James, we just spoke of him, who became the apostle over the church in Jerusalem. He was martyred in the AD 60s, according to Josephus. Peter was crucified upside down he didn't think he was worthy to be crucified in the same manner of the Christ in the 60s. Paul was stoned on the Appian Way, stoned to death in the 60s. Doubting Thomas, the one that said, unless I put my hand in the holes, my fingers in the holes of your hands, I'll not believe. He was a skeptic, a doubter. Something changed him from the skeptic to after the resurrection, and he had met the resurrected Christ. He goes to southern India, Kerala, India, and spends the rest of his life there testifying of this resurrected God-man. Eventually martyred there. They speared him to death there. What would motivate a person to do that? Certainly not a lie. If they had made the whole thing up, why would he leave his family, his culture? Why would they leave, you know, everything that was familiar and comfortable and go to someplace totally different, hostile to his message, and live the rest of his life there? I would propose the resurrection fits the bill quite well. Why would anyone, many of these people dying for their crime, why would anyone die for a known lie? And that's a question you have to ask. It wasn't that like someone dies for something they believe to be true, but is not. These guys, especially James, the half-brother of Jesus, these guys were right there at the time, at the place. They of all people would know if Jesus really didn't raise from the dead. If they were making the story up, why would they die believing that? Why would they die with that on their breath? You might say, well, not all of the disciples died martyr's death. That's true. John is an example. He lived into the AD 90s. John was the last of the living apostles. It says that he was exiled to the island of Patmos by the Emperor Domitian in AD 95. Now, don't think the island of Patmos being like Fiji or one of the tropical islands where he's sipping on cool drinks as he's, you know, sitting in the sand there. He was a political prisoner there. He was a religious prisoner there by the emperor. In Patmos, they were made to dig out quarries and mines. John was about 89 years of age. All he would have had to do to get off that island was to say, nah, we made it up. The boys are all dead. Gig is up. We made it all up. Let me go free. But he didn't. He lived out his life, as far as we know, writing the book of Revelation on the Isle of Patmos. So, reviewing the facts we've gone over, we've seen, one, that the burial location of Jesus was known. And if anybody wanted to try and prove that Jesus really was still dead, they knew where he was buried. Also, he was buried by Joseph of Arimathea, the unlikely hero. If you're making this stuff up, you don't make him to be the hero. The third, it was a non-embellished finding of the empty tomb. Very simple account by women who weren't considered good witnesses in the first century. The tomb was verified as empty. Even the Jews tried to say, let's say somebody stole it. Jesus appeared, there were many, many eyewitnesses to Jesus' appearance. The Bible says over 500. Many of them were hostile. Luke wrote to excellent Theophilus. He wrote history to an important person. He wouldn't have made that up or made a story or history or something fictional like that. And then lastly, the disciples. They believed in a resurrection even though they weren't expecting one, and it was contrary to expectations. The disciples' lives were radically changed and transformed. They were fearless. And the disciples lived and died for what they saw and what they were witnesses to. If it were made up, they wouldn't have lived their lives telling people and being stoned and beaten and persecuted and even killed sometimes if it weren't true. So you might have come into this Easter with just the six facts that we talked about. And that's quite okay. But hopefully I've provided a more firm foundation, a sure foundation. The next time someone asks, why are you a Christian? Say, well, because Jesus really did rise from the dead, just like he said. And hopefully you'll be able to remember a few of these things. Now, perhaps you're listening today and you don't have a firm foundation for your faith. Maybe you don't have a faith. There's no firm foundation for your life, but you thought, gee, this does make sense that God sent a man and proved that he was of God because he rose from the dead. If you want to receive Christ into your life, if you want him to become a part of your life, then you can pray about it right here and right now through time and distance in this podcast. You can just pray in your heart, say, dear God, thank you that you love me. Thank you that you sent Jesus to die on a cross for me. I'm sorry, God, that I've not worshiped Jesus. I'm sorry, God, that I've done many wrong and bad things in my life. Forgive me. I believe that Jesus died. I believe that he rose again from the dead. Jesus, I ask you to come and be a part of my life. I give it to you. Help me to live my life for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So when we've celebrated Resurrection Day today, that's exactly what Easter is. The historical fact that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. Something to be happy about. O death, where is your sting? O grave, where is your victory? God bless you this Easter.